Levi, we want to give you the opportunity to finish your thoughts.
Yes, and I appreciate you holding me over to the break. What I said was Dr. Ofari Hutchinson, when he quoted the 2%, I said to myself, I said, these black academics are very crafty. Because when you say 2%, let's talk about the 98% of the success ratio of police officers who abuse and kill black folks. See, if you say 98%, then it's going to cause the listener to say, wait a minute. Well, what has Al Sharpton and his initiatives and the civil rights initiatives and those who are of his ilk done? What has Jesse Jackson done? What has it produced? We are dying more in the streets of America at our own hands and at the hands of those of a white supremacist mind than we were back during Jim Crow and slavery in these times. We own less businesses. We don't own nothing after that civil rights initiative was put forth. Our schools are dysfunctional, producing dysfunctional illiterates. We are gone as a people. But the truth of the matter is that philosophy that Mr. Ofari Hutchinson promotes, Mr. Warren, you yourself, Andre, Al Sharpton, that antiquated philosophy and what Dr. King placed on the table, if it were a drug, it would definitely be recalled because of the side effects that we are now witnessing. I'm in downtown Detroit.
All right, Levi, okay, man. Let's let Reverend Warren respond to that.
I hope Levi stays on the call. What philosophy are you talking about, my brother? Because I didn't know there was one philosophy that guided black folk. What's that philosophy?
I'm going to tell you what the philosophy is, Mr. D.
Let's hear.
The philosophy is there's nothing in the Bible that says to us, if someone hates you, if someone wants to kill you, God would never tell a people, especially his people, to lay down and let people stick dogs on them, fire hoses on them, beat them to death. Because when you look at that philosophy and you look at where we are today, it was that philosophy, and you believe in that philosophy as a Christian preacher, you will never say, if someone tries to kill you, God tells you to defend yourself like everything else he created defends itself. It is that philosophy.
Time out. You're making a big assumption here, because one, you don't know me nor my preaching, so you don't know what I'm saying. So one, I'm not going to tell anyone who's big, if someone attacks me or my family, I'm not going to say, well, I'm going to sit there and take it. That's one, but that's different. The philosophy of the civil rights movement is King's appropriation of Gandhi's philosophy of nonviolence. It's intentional. It had an intent and an intentional outcome. That's one. So that was the Gandhian philosophy appropriated by King and many others who've done that. It's not the standard philosophy of all civil rights activists, of all black activists across the board. And it is not the standing philosophy for all Christians as well. There's several philosophies. You want to talk philosophies. There's moments where there's inappropriate behavior in Bible and Scripture where Jesus turns over tables and beats the people, makes cords and beats them. So there are people who also understand the kind of transformative work of Jesus in that light. What I also would caution you is being kind of generalistic and all-encompassing with your critiques. Everyone you name doesn't necessarily follow the same philosophy. It doesn't have the same approach to this. And then when you talk about people trained in white academics, I don't even know what a white academic are trained in that regard. What it looks like, what you're alluding to, if it has to do with institutions that shape us or make us. My training in philosophy, by the way, was at Morehouse College. That's one. That's the next piece. I would just caution that we have a tendency in our community that when we want to be critical of an approach or critical of someone's approach or their philosophy or their way of thinking, we feel that we have to make what they call these ad hominem attacks, which are these personal attacks. If you cannot make a critique of someone's thinking without making a critique of them as individuals, then your critiques really have a lot of validity because they're not standing on anything beyond the validity of your personal attack of the individual. That's one. So I always caution you that it's possible to have a conversation with different points of view without having to, one, become upset or two, criticizing the individual, especially when you don't know people well enough to criticize them. So I just caution that we have productive conversations about your views and my views and still move forward without having to be critical of one another and do so with the intent to lift and elevate one another at the same time and our community. Because at the end of the day, that's the work that most of us are engaged in. How do we participate in the transformation of our communities? Have we gotten it right all the time? No. Have we done it the right way all the time? No. But we sure won't get it right if we sit around just taking pot shots at one another instead of trying to come together and find ways to lift one another, period.
Well said. Levi, we appreciate the call. I don't have to add anything to that at all. 877-532-5797. But I agree with every single word came out of Reverend Michael A. Walron's mouth. 877-532-5797. Let's go to line 8. Wayne joining us from Chicago, listening on 1690 WVON, home of the Governor Cliff Kelly. Wayne, welcome to Keeping It Real with Reverend Al Sharpton. You got Reverend Michael A. Walron and yours truly, your thoughts.
Yeah, thank you. Yes, I just wanted to say, people who live in the countries like France, Britain, the United States, we have become comfortably numb. I'll give you an example. Like here in the United States, a person will come home from work, cut on the news, they'll hear a story about Britain or France dropping bombs on those people in the Middle East. They don't even give it a second thought. They just go in the kitchen and start fixing dinner. But those people who those bombs were dropped on, they give it a second thought. They're not comfortably numb. They want revenge. So I don't understand why people are so excited and surprised when stuff like this happens. The British have been dropping bombs on innocent people in the Middle East for a while now under NATO. France, when that concert happened, when they killed all those people at that concert, the French have been dropping bombs on innocent people in the Middle East for a long time now. So when you kill somebody's family, they want revenge. So I don't understand what's all the hoopla about. When we stop doing what we're doing in the Middle East, that's when these things maybe will calm down. But as long as we are over there, we're the ones who open up the gates of hell in the Middle East. The United States and using NATO, we are the ones who did this. We are the ones who created ISIS. And as far as the DNC email hack, even Israeli intelligence has looked into it and said, no, the Russians did not do it. So this investigation right now is just them trying to get their lies straight. And I'm done. Thank you.
All right, Wayne, we appreciate that call. Reverend Walron, you got anything you want to respond to on that?
Yeah, the only thing I would say is that one thing that he pointed out among the many things is that in this country, the truth is we are very ignorant about foreign policy and what takes place around the world. And it's because of the kind of insulated way we engage our own country and the way the media kind of makes people abreast of certain things around the world. So I would say that the reason why we're often shocked and often taken aback is because very rarely do you hear the acts that America has inflicted upon other parts of the world. And so we sometimes believe that we're going into these places with clean hands, and that's not necessarily the case. And so I think the average American does not have a lot of knowledge of foreign policy. The average American does not have great knowledge of American acts and atrocities around the world. And that's why we are so taken off guard by these acts of terror, because we don't know the long history of terror committed by many, progressive nations around the world.
All right, I hear the music. That means we got to take a break. That means, folks, stick around, because when we come back on the other side, we're going to continue this discussion. We're going to talk about the bombing in Manchester. We're going to talk about a whole lot right here on Keeping It Real with Reverend Al Sharpton and you at 877-532-579.